All right, guys, so this is going to be an update to the first video I did on the longitudinal controls design for the XFLR plane. There's one additional thing we need to look at, and that is looking at the impact of system damping on the controller design. So in the first video, for the aerodynamics model, we only looked at the basically the forces and moments due to angle of attack and control surface deflection. Those are big parts. There's one other big part that we need to look at, and that is the impact on system damping. So basically, as your pitch rate changes, that's going to have a damping effect or a damping moment, and that's going to impact the controller design. So in order to do that, we're going to have to do a stability analysis in XFLR to be able to pull out those damping derivatives. We'll take that. We're going to throw it into our Simulink model, look at the impact of the updated pole locations, compare that with what the XFLR stability analysis predicts, and then we're going to update the controller design. Alright, so the first thing I'm going to do, let's open up XFLR, and I'm going to open our project from last time. Alright, so this is the last state it was in. I'm going to go ahead and switch to the neutral configuration. So this is with the elevator at the neutral position. And I am going to go to analysis, define a stability analysis this time. So the first page, pretty much gonna leave blank for the reference dimensions. We set this on the other analysis, but we're gonna set it on here too. We're gonna change the reference area to the wing plan form. And then the rest of this, we can leave blank. So we'll hit okay. And then under analysis settings, I'm gonna run just at the zero control parameter. Hit analyze. It goes, it does its thing, and then now we have a dynamic stability analysis, and we can look at what XFLR predicts the mode locations to be. So if we hit animate, you can kind of see this is an animation of the short period response. So I'm going to speed this up a little bit. You can kind of see the damping we see from that short period. And it's predicting that first mode is going to be at 4.6 hertz, and it's going to have a damping ratio of 0.89. We can also look at where it predicts the fugoid to be. And we'll see, you know, this is a lot slower, a lot less damped, just like we would predict from our Simulink model from before. So in order to get the data we need, which is really just CMQ, there's other damping terms we can include in the model as well. But I think for the purposes of our design, just including CMQ, I think is going to give us enough fidelity to make sure that the controller is being tuned against an accurate model of the system. And we'll compare what the pole locations are in Simulink with what XFLR predicts too, and hopefully they'll be pretty similar. So, let's see. We can press L, and that's going to pull up the log file. And this is going to show the results from the latest analysis that was performed. And if we scroll down a little bit, we can see where it calculates our longitudinal derivatives. We're going to see CMQ. So I'm going to take this value. I'm going to go in MATLAB. Let's see. And I have my aero data mat file from before. I'm going to load that up. And I'm also now going to define CMQ to be equal to this times pi over 180. And the reason I'm doing that is because by default, that CMQ is going to be your damping per radian per second. And for us, we're going to feedback the pitch rate in degrees per second. So we're going to multiply by pi over 180 to have the equivalent effect when we're looking at degrees per second. All right, so we have that. I'm going to take it, drag it into our aero data mat file so that we have it next time we load this up. And I'm going to open up our plant model from before. All right, so let's do this. So let's go ahead. We're going to right-click on the plant model. Actually, we probably can't compile it yet because we need to add a few things. So I recall from before, we at least have to specify our initial velocity. So I'm going to put that at 30. Angle of attack, we'll do like 1 degree. Gamma, we'll do like negative 5 degrees. I think that might be it. So if I go back to my Simulink model, press Control-D to compile. Yeah, so that's everything. So what we can do now, we're going to right-click on our plant model, go to Linear Analysis, Linearize Block. And let's see, it's going to be the block. We're going to just do our initial conditions. We're not going to trim it. The reason you can get away with that is because the elevator position doesn't have it doesn't change our system dynamics. On some systems, your pitch rate due to elevator deflection, that derivative is also dependent on where your elevator actually is and its travel. For our design, since it's pretty simplistic, it doesn't really matter, which is why I'm not going to bother trimming the model. So let's go ahead. We're going to do a pole zero map. Just to kind of, so we can look at the impact, and you'll, I think it'll be kind of cool because you'll see the impact of including the damping, and you'll see how it shifts the poles and all that good stuff. So I think this is looking familiar from last time. I recall we had a barely unstable fugoid. If we zoom in over there, let's see. Barely stable. Do we have the right C? Do we have the right C? I don't know. Let's see. Because I think before we had a crazy chord. Okay, so yeah, that'll look right. Alright. Whatever. Looks close enough. And the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take this Linsys one, I'm going to drag it from the linear analysis workspace, I'm going to drag it to the MATLAB workspace, that way we can do some plots later and compare what the response looks like. So I'm going to close this for now, and let's go back, let's just run the model so we can remember where exactly we are. So I just did Control T to run it, and I'm going to open up the plotter, the data inspector. And okay, so right now this is configured with a PI, the outer, and a PI on the inner. I think we also showed pretty good results just having the proportional on the outer. I'm going to leave it as a PI on the outer for now. And we can kind of see our system response. So now, what we're going to do is we're going to modify the Simulink model to take into account the damping. So we go inside our plan model, let's go into arrow. Yeah, sometimes Simulink just does not remember the straight lines. It's really frustrating. All right, and we know we're going to have one more input. So we type N1, and this is going to be our pitch rate. So I'm going to call that Q, and let's go ahead, let's go up here on the outside, and let's connect this. So our pitch rate comes from right here, omega Y. I'm going to go ahead and make a little bit more room for myself. Scoot this down. I just control click and drag to duplicate the block. And we're going to hook this up to omega y, which is in radians per second. This is going to get converted to degrees per second. We will hook that up to Q. So now we're feeding in our pitch rate in degrees per second. That's what we want to do. So now let's go down in here. Now what we need, CMQ, that gets multiplied by our non-dimensional angular velocity. So in order to get that, we got to do a couple things. We're going to need our actual velocity. So we have that up here for our atmosphere dynamic pressure. So I'm going to control click and drag, and you notice I got an option to paste or duplicate. I'm going to duplicate, and what this does is it just says, hey, I've got another copy of this velocity port that I can work with. It just makes the model a little bit cleaner. So the velocity, you'll notice it's the same number. It's one right here. It's going to be one up here. So you're going to get the same velocity signal coming in here. Now I know my non-dimensional pitch rate is going to be basically my pitch rate times C over 2V. Then I'm going to take that, multiply it by my pitch damping, my CMQ, and then that's going to get added to my overall pitching moment coefficient, my CM, which then gets multiplied by C, and then S, and then dynamic pressure. So this is our pitching moment that's coming out of here. I'm going to go ahead and move this block around and then create a sum block just so that we can add not only the angle of attack and pitching moment, I'm sorry, the angle of attack and control deflection contribution, but also we can add in the pitch damping as well. So I know we have to take Q, we have to multiply it by C over 2V. So I'm gonna have C right here. I've got my velocity. I'm gonna multiply that by 2. And then I'm gonna do a divide. So now I've got my pitching rate, or my pitch rate in degrees per second times C divided by 2 times V. Move this around a little bit. And then from that, we need to multiply by our damping coefficient. So I'm going to have another gain here. This is going to be called CMQ, which we defined in the workspace. And then that's going to get added to our overall pitching moment coefficient, which then gets dimensionalized. So I'll save that. Go back out here, see if we can compile. Doesn't seem to be complaining about that. And now I'm going to relinearize this. So right click, linear analysis, linearize block. And we're going to do the same thing where we just do a pole zero map. And I'm going to take this, I'm going to rename it, right click, rename Linsys 2. Throw it in the MATLAB workspace. and then I'm going to go back to the command prompt, and I'm going to do a PZ map for lenSys1, which is what the dynamics were before, and lenSys2. Then let's look. So you can see this made quite a bit of impact. So our short period here, the frequency or the damping ratio is similar, so that all looks good, but the frequency is a lot higher. So we went from 13 radians per second, 13 and a half, all the way up to around 26 and a half radians per second. And you'll also notice that this helps stabilize our fugoid as well. So we went from basically right on the edge of instability, and just pulled this in, increased the damping a bit, and then also increased the frequency a little bit as well. So that did good things. So damping is good for stability. We like that. So now what we need to do, well, before we do that, let's compare this with what XFLR estimates. So what I can do is, lenSys2 is our updated system. I can type damp lenSys2. What this is going to do is this is going to tell me the frequency and damping ratio for all of the system poles. So the first one is the integrated at the origin for the pitch angle. We're going to ignore that one. And the two we're interested in, we've got one here at 26 and a half radians per second, and we've got one here at 0.7 radians per second. This is our short period here, which is a 0.86 damping ratio, and then our fugoid has a 0.13. So let's go ahead, let's take these two frequencies, convert it to hertz. I'm going to take this, divide it by 2 times pi. So this is going to predict our short periods at 4.2 hertz, and then our fugoid is going to be at, let's see, around 0.11 hertz. So let's see how that compares with XFLR. So if I go back here, so XFLR thinks that our short period is at 4.6, so we're pretty close, 4.2, 4.6, and then the damping ratio for the short period is 0.89, we were predicting 0.86, and then our fugoid, we switch to this one, is 0.1 hertz, 0.1-ish hertz, and then 0.098 for damping, 0.13. So it's decently close. It's not exact, and that's because XFLR has a few other terms that we're neglecting in the Simulink model, but I think we've captured the, you know, certainly it's a lot closer than it was before, and I think it's going to be good enough for us to do the controls design. So we're feeling pretty good about that. Let's go ahead and let's look and see if we didn't adjust our controller, what does the performance look like? I think that'll be kind of interesting. So I'm going to close this, close the linear analysis, and let's go back. And so this is set, it's going to overwrite the run, which is what we want. So let's get a good picture of what this looks like. And then, or actually, you know, we'll just overlay them. So I'll deselect overwrite run. We're going to run this again. And then I'm just going to overlay them manually. So we have the same reference, but now you'll notice theta is a lot more oscillatory. Q, same sort of story. Elevator, yeah, a lot more activity. And then angle of attack. Yeah, so we need to retune the controller. I'm gonna go ahead and delete this run just to make my life easier. And then I'm gonna right click on the first one and say overwrite run. So I'll just go ahead, we'll run it again. So now it's updated with the new response. So let's retune the inner loop. So I'm gonna disconnect the outer loop by deleting this signal right there. Double click on the rate PI, hit the tuner. Okay, so you'll see that the dashed line here was our response before. I'm also going to, let's display the open loop Bode plot and the control effort. And we're going to adjust the range here. 0.01 to 1000. So let's look at that, and then we're also going to display our margins. So margins-wise, the previous time looked pretty good. So it looked like it was stable. It was a little more oscillatory. It's definitely more sluggish than what we can get right now. But you know, I don't think we would have fallen out of the sky. Hopefully not. But we've got our new aero data, our better plant model. So let's go ahead and retune it. I'm probably going to slow it down a little bit from what we've got here. basically I'm going to ring this up right until the point where I start to get a little bit of ringing. So probably right around there. Okay, I'll update the block. Let's close this. You can see margins still look good. 70 degrees phase margin, 14 dB gain margin. Close that. I think we got the inner loop looking good. And then I'm going to take another look at the outer loop. We'll retune this one. You'll notice I also reconnected that inner loop before I'm tuning the outer loop. And let's add the same plots. Okay. And if we speed it up a little bit. Maybe right around there. I kind of like that. I don't think it's going to be too bad. Control effort looks decent. We might need to slow it down a little bit. We'll look at what the nonlinear time domain simulation looks like before we make that call. If you look at our margins, it's going to be the solid line. So 60 degrees phase, around 15 dB gains. That still looks pretty good. So let's update the block. We'll go ahead and close this. Hit OK. And we'll compare the response again. So I'm going to uncheck the overwrite. Control T to run it. I'm running for 10 seconds. And then here, I'm going to relook at theta. So theta looks a lot cleaner, much better. Q, I'm guessing, is also going to look cleaner. Yep. Angle of attack. And elevator. Yeah, much better. So the cool thing was, when we added in that system damping, that actually helped our controller design too, because the controller doesn't have to do as much to stabilize the airframe. You're going to get that natural sort of opposing pitching moment when you have that pitch rate, and that's going to act to kind of help you help you regulate those short period dynamics. So that's why we're able to get pretty good response out of the controller. Now you notice the control effort is pretty similar to what it was before. So I think this is all looking pretty good. I think the updates that we've done will help you out. It wouldn't have been the end of the world if we were running with this other one, but certainly we have a lot cleaner looking response if we update this. And I think this also kind of goes to show the importance of the accuracy of your model. So the difference between the model previously and the one we have now was the incorporation of the pitch damping. But again, these are all just estimates out of what XFLR has given you. And if you have the geometry and the mass properties modeled well inside of XFLR, I think that's going to get you most of the way, because it'll probably do a decent job of modeling your primary aerodynamic impacts. But it's certainly not going to have anything with the fuselage. And then during your boost, it's not going to know anything about the moment that you're going to have due to the offset of the engine with respect to the CG. So that's stuff that you're still going to have to take into account. You could model that in Simulink and then see what the impact would be. That'd probably be a good exercise as well. But ideally, you'd want to run some CFD and see, does the CFD results, do they match up with the system level sort of stability characteristics that you're getting out of XFLR? Hopefully you get those two in agreement, and then from that, you should be, I would be pretty confident in the control design. But that's everything for the longitudinal design. I think it's in a good place. The next video is going to go through the lateral autopilot design. That one's going to be a long one because I think what I'm going to do, I'm just going to go through, develop a full six-off model with all of our aero, and then I'll just take the pitch design that we have here, and then from that we'll work on the lateral design. So until next time, good luck.